So next couple of minutes, I'll be sharing my thoughts on AI for diabetic retinopathy screening. So what do the diabetic retinopathy screening guidelines say about using AI? And very recently, 2020, American Diabetic Association has included AI for DR screening as one of the thing in their guidelines. And they suggest that one can use any AI system which can detect more than mild NPDR and DME, authorized by FDA as an alternative to a traditional screening approach. However, they went ahead saying that the result of these examinations should be documented and transmitted to a healthcare professional, meaning they want to complete the loop. When AI should not be used? So patients who have known retinopathy, they should directly be seen by an ophthalmologist. Or if there is a prior retinopathy treatment history, again, AI should not be used. Or if a patient has a symptom of visual impairment, again, AI is not something which should be used in that. In these patients, they should be seen by in person by an ophthalmologist. What do the AIOS guidelines say? So this was a work which we had done, and the consensus was that because we don't have any legal framework for using AI today, it's empirical that if there is diabetic retinopathy detected by AI, they should be seen by an ophthalmologist. And a subset of those who are not detected as DR, they are normals, at least 10% of them, these images should be graded by an ophthalmologist too. However, these things will change as the algorithms become more mature. Are these algorithms accurate? So this was our initial work in 2016, where we started. This was one of the first study which showed that deep learning can be used to detect diabetic retinopathy. And happy to share that this article was judged as the top 10 article of the decade last year by JAMA. And then there have been many studies which have looked into development and validation of algorithm. The good thing is accuracies of most of them is reasonably good. That becomes more confusing that how you select an AI algorithm in your clinical care or when you want to do it for your screening. One must look into the original study which was used for validation, how many number of images were used for a training set. In our JAMA study, we had found a cutoff of 60,000 images, that after that, the AI training doesn't improve much. So if you have less number of images, you should think about how good the algorithm would be. How the ground truth was ascertained is very important because algorithm learns from what has been told to it. There are a variety of ways the grading or the ground truth can be ascertained. It can be a single ophthalmologist, a retina specialist, can be multiple grading, education, like two people telling and a third educating it. You must look at how nicely the ground truth has been ascertained, because that will give how robust the AI algorithm is. Whether the algorithm was trained on a mydriatic image or a non-mydriatic image. Dr. Natarajan's work on a non-mydriatic image, that means that will work pretty good. Those algorithms will work if you use a non-mydriatic camera. I think that is again an important thing you must look for. And whether the algorithm was trained on a single field or it was used, they had used multiple fields like IDX. They had used multiple fields. So though the algorithm is good, but if in India, when we use a single posterior pole image, it may not be that accurate in detecting diabetic retinopathy. So selecting algorithm depends on the circumstances of intended screening, where you want to screen, which is there. You want to use a non-mydriatic camera, mydriatic camera, single field, multiple field. All these things play a role. Is the performance of an algorithm dependent on camera? So this was our work in Thailand, where we had multiple cameras across various districts. So 10 cameras, variety of them, non-mydriatic, mydriatic. We compared the AI versus human grading. So you can see that once the image is gradable, the human grading showed so much variation, whereas AI grading, irrespective of which camera was used, was pretty accurate. However, if it's a non-gradable image, both human and AI, the performance was poor. So the lesson is that for gradable images, the performance of AI algorithm seems to be similar across the cameras. There are efforts to improve the efficiency of AI algorithms now, and this is one of our recent work where we tried, this is a work, again, multi-centric across globe, about 7 countries data was pooled in, that if we label the OCT thicknesses to detect macular edema. So if you can see the second image, on the retinal photograph, you cannot see macular edema. But when this image was trained using the OCT data, because the patient has center-involving DME, it can even detect that with a fairly good accuracy. The AUC is of nearly 0.9. These type of algorithms are the future, where DME detection would be in par with the OCT using a retinal image itself. This is another work which we have done with the Smart India Study Group, where we tried looking at the non-gradability, if we can detect whether an image would be gradable or non-gradable. With a very high accuracy, we could detect them. These are using non-midriatic images. And why it is important? Because if we can say that, okay, because the image is ungradable because of these features, we can ask the photographer to retake the image. There are a couple of implementation strategies which are there, how we can implement it in our practice. One way Dr. Kim and group in Arvind have been using it as a fully automated mode, where they have kept these cameras at a physician clinic who have very poor knowledge of grading diabetic retinopathy. Images are uploaded and the AI tells whether to refer or not, or use it as an assistive mode, as we have been doing it in our hospital, placing these in an interior segment specialist who have less knowledge about DR. They upload the image, they also grade diabetic retinopathy, and then the AI grading is shown to them and they get a chance to augment their grading. This is a short video telling that how we have integrated it with our EMR. So the optometrist, when they do the workup, they take a consent and upload the retinal images also. Along with uploading the image, they also upload the other features, like whether the cataract is there, whether the pupil was dilated or undilated image was taken. So this is the optometrist part. Then he goes to a physician or a consultant ophthalmologist. He opens the image and he also has a chance to grade these images with the severity of DME and DR. He's shown the AI result now and he has a chance to change it if required or use the same grading. So this is how we have been using at Shankarnethralaya now. And this is the initial 350 patients. If you look, the result, the AUCs are pretty similar to what we had shown in the JAMA paper. So in the real life, it works pretty well. This is regarding the referable diabetic retinopathy. The sensitivity specificities are pretty same what the initial development studies has shown. We also used another AI system, which is developed in Korea, to think of a different implementation mode. We use these images, and the images, the ground truth was grading by a retina specialist, and we kept it at a glaucoma clinic. And we saw that, can we reduce the referrals from glaucoma clinic to a retina clinic? And we can see pretty good AUC of detecting diabetic retinopathy, referable diabetic retinopathy. So that means the mild and moderate cases could be managed at the glaucoma clinic itself. This is one of the case scenario of reducing the referral to a retina clinic. What is the acceptance level of AI among ophthalmologists? Many of you would have done this survey, which was given in the last lockdown, the APRAISE study done by Dr. Daniel Ting. Across 70 countries, more than 1,176 ophthalmologists tried looking at what is the acceptance and perception of AI. And you'll be soon seeing it in Lancet, a beautiful paper. And even we tried using machine learning to look into, predict the acceptance of AI. And what we found, it's pretty good acceptance, especially in this COVID crisis, the willingness to adopt. People have been using mainly for diabetic retinopathy. Again, more preference to use it as an assistive tool. People are also trying to use it as a diagnostic or a clinical decision. And The common barrier is the medical liability. This is something which people are worried about. Thank you very much.